Thank you, Nilesh, for this introduction. And at the first, I'd like to thank the organizing committee and especially Ipe Cherian for putting up this great show for youngsters. I hope everyone is having a great time and learning this anatomy. So today I'll be talking about comparative anatomy of cavernous sinus. It's an academic study. So as you all know, skull base is a very vast area, and all the skull base, we have the cavernous sinus, which is the main area, and we have our internal carotid artery is the main artery, which enters the from outside, travels in the petrous bone, then in the cavernous sinus, then it goes intracranial. So most of our discussions are in the skull base are focused around internal carotid artery, especially when we are seeing this now endoscopic approaches. They are all centered around the internal carotid artery. But in the previous time, as you know, this Parkinson triangle and all these triangles, they were described in relation to approach this artery. These nerves were which was coming in the way, they acted as a geometrical triangular areas. So they were described in the literature for the communication of various this thing. But as you know, these all these lesions and all these pathology, they don't understand these triangles, they don't understand how these things are we are describing. They have their own way of involving the critical areas. But for a better communication, for learning, we need to know how this anatomy is working. Anatomy is same whether you watch it through endoscope, whether you watch it through microscope, but the perspective changes. So thing is, when we as a neurosurgeon, we are so used to watching this anatomy from the top. Once we are introduced through the endoscope, we get sometimes get confused. So let's try to lower this confusion. Of course, you have to do a lot of hands-on dissections. You have to go to lab. You have to do cases. And then you have to see the pathologies, how these pathologies are distorting that anatomy, how this anatomy will help you in removing those pathologies. So let's see first the triangles in a summary. You have the three group of triangles. We have cavernous sinus triangle, we have middle fossa triangles, then we have the paraclival triangles. So this almost cover whole of the middle fossa and some part of the anterior cranial base and some part of the posterior cranial base. So as you all know, we have the four cavernous sinus triangles, which are related to cavernous sinus. We have a clinoidal triangle, we have oculomotor, then we have supratrochlear and infratrochlear. And once you are infratrochlear, then you are outside the cavernous sinus. We are in the middle fossa. We have four triangular areas, which are not always very much triangular, as you know. So we have anterior medial, we have anterior lateral, then we have posterior lateral, then posterior medial in a clockwise way. So anterior medial, anterior lateral, posterior lateral, and posterior medial. And then we have, of course, two triangles, which are paraclivar, inferior lateral and inferior medial. So this is a picture of the skull base, which we were just seeing. You can see all of the, this is the middle cellar area. We have anterior clinoids. We have our, this wedge-shaped petrous bone, which goes inside and it, which is basically a thin chondrosis, and it forms our petroclival fissure and sphenopetrosal fissure. And the junction of these two fissures, we have opening foramen and lacerum. And through there, your ICA enters into the intracranial compartment. So you have to imagine this all 3D anatomy. You have to imagine in your mind. Then you will be able to better appreciate. So my connection is a little slow. So you see, once we know this, now, this is a frontal view, which we generally see through our endoscopic areas. We have here our and the sphenosinus. So this is the front. I want to show one this lingual process. Just remember, this is a lingual process. This is the projection from sphenoid backward. Here we have attachment of the petrolingual ligament. So from petrous to lingual. And this is the point where ICA enter inside the cavernous sinus. This is the, we are very much confused sometimes this, which is the cavernous ICA, which is the outside the cavernous ICA. So technically this is the point where we have of petrolingual ligament. Come to the rings also. So if you see this anatomy from microscopic point of view, you can see here the oculomotor triangle, you can see here the clinoidal triangle. Of course, now you with the lateral side, you can see all the triangles, supratrochlear, infratrochlear. You have anteromedial, anterolateral, posterolateral, and posteromedial. You can see beautifully here is the your Kawase triangle. So these are your clival triangles. So coming back to the endoscopic view, this is the main working area in the endoscope. We know a good pneumatized sphenoid sinus is the main room which gives you access to almost all of the skull base with your endoscopic instrument. Of course, this is again very beautifully pneumatization of the carotid. Sometimes this bone is very thin and it may be deficient, so we have to be careful. So you have the optic strut. So we'll be coming to that also. So all these anatomical points, they are important when you are doing operations in this area, whether you are doing it microscopically or endoscopically. So if you see now, this is the OCR. So this is the picture after removal of the bone. So now you can see all the arteries, inferior hypophyseal artery, you have dorsal meningeal artery. You can see how the paraclival internal carotid artery, it is going and it is forming a C-shaped curve, which is the cellar part of the internal carotid artery. And then it goes intracranially. So endoscopically, this whole anatomy changes. Here we are not dealing with the triangles. Here we are dealing with the compartments. We have a medial compartment, lateral compartment of the cavernous sinus. So this is the lateral, this is the oblique view of the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus. You can see this C-shaped curve and you can see some part of the lateral cavernous wall. So if you try to medialize, or of course it is, if it's just for the anatomy, not sometimes practical. So you can medialize the ICA and then you can see whole of the third nerve. Here you can see third nerve entering the roof and going along the lateral wall. And you can see the sixth nerve traveling inside the cavernous sinus. Of course, it is lateral to ICA and medial to the lateral wall. So sixth nerve is the only nerve which is traveling inside the cavernous sinus. So coming to specific triangles, we have clinoidal triangle. Of course, it is between the it is medial to the anterior clinoid. So here we have taken out the clinoid process. You can see this is the lot of youngster, they get confused where is carotid collar, which is proximal ring, distal ring, carotid oculomotor membrane. So these pictures will try to, you know, remove that confusion. Now you can see this clinoidal part of the ICA, it is very much well defined when you see through endoscope. From microscopic point of view, it is sometimes not that well defined. Of course, now you can see here is the distal ring. Here is the proximal ring. And you can see this proximal ring is not that adherent to the adventitia. There is some venous space. So that's why it is called a loose. So you see, if I see from endoscope, now you come from the, if you see this picture, so the dura, which is below your anterior clinoid, is your proximal ring. And if you see from this side, I've shown you, this is the optic strut. So there is a dural membrane, which is below this. This is your proximal ring, and this is your distal ring. And the compartment or this triangle between this is the, your intraclinoidal ICA. So this is intraclinoidal ICA here. So here I have medialized, I have this moved ICA just to show here, even anterior clinoid has been drilled. So you can see how this is anterior clinoid, and just below anterior clinoid, you can see third nerve traveling like this. And on top, you can see this is ophthalmic artery. Of course, this is now intracranial part of the ICA. So oculomotor triangle, again, very interesting triangle. Here we have three boundaries, which are three ligaments, which are connecting anterior clinoid, posterior clinoid, and your petrous apex. And in the center, you can see third nerve entering. And this is the top view here. And this is the lateral view, third nerve entering this as a cisternal kind of opening here. Then it immediately, after some time, goes into the lateral aspect. So this is the oculomotor triangle. And if you see from below, you can see this C-shaped. I have tried to just lower this part of the ICA. And you can see their third nerve entering on both the sides. You can see this is the third nerve. So this is that oculomotor triangular area if you try to see endoscope. And many of the pituitary tumors, they can go in this part of the ICA and part of the cavernous sinus. And then they can, if you are not careful, you can damage part of the third nerve here. So if you know this anatomy, then of course you will be more careful. Of course, supratrochlear, fourth nerve is one of the thinnest nerve just below the third nerve. And supratrochlear space is very narrow, and infratrochlear is little more, which is Parkinson triangle. So here we have this sixth nerve here. If you remove this three, you can see thinly here is the fourth nerve and very narrow area, not possible to explore endoscopically. Of course, sometimes what these lesions do is they expand these spaces. So if you know anatomy, then these spaces can be created. So these pathologies can create these spaces for you. So this is, of course, infratrochlear, below the trochlea, over the V1 here. And this is a large space. It's a Parkinson triangle, as you all know. And it gives you access to this vertical part of ICA, meningohypophyseal trunk. And of course, this is the sixth nerve here. And from below, of course, from endoscope, again, you can see this is the infratrochlear. This is the third nerve. Third nerve is practically, you can say, fourth nerve. Fourth nerve is not possible to see in this specimen. So this is basically infratrochlear space here. So coming to the middle fossa triangles, of course, anteromedial, I've already explained. So this is between V1 and V2 here is your anteromedial, and between V2 and V3 is your anterolateral triangles. So endoscopically, of course, if you have done this dissection, this is the V2 here, this is the V1 and V2. And this, if you remove this space, is not always constant. That depends upon the configuration of your trigeminal branches. Sometimes they are very close, sometimes they are very far. And of course, if you see this opening, it gives access to your middle fossa. This is part of the temporal lobe, which you can see here. So this is from the ventral aspect. And this is again anterolateral. Anterolateral, you can see here, there is a lot of space here between V2 here and V3 going vertically here. With this, also there is a mystery sinus between pterygoid plexus and the cavernous sinus. So this again can give you a lot of access. This is, of course, now we are going into infratemporal area also. So this is also giving you a lot of access to the middle cranial fossa. And in this specimen, you can see the whole of this clival dissection. You can see some part of the V2, and you can see branches of V3 here. So posteromedial, again, quasi triangle. This is medial. So this is medial. This is a quadrangular piece of the bone, which if you can remove, then you get access to, in this picture, you can see there is access to basilar artery and whole of the anterior part of your this brainstem. So again, endoscopically, of course, it is difficult to see, but you see if I have just tried to retract this trigeminal, and this is lateral to your ICA, and this is the part which we saw in the microscopic picture. And if you try to go behind the ICA, it is possible to go here. You can see this is petrous apex. So we are drilling the petrous apex. This is, you can see the sixth nerve, how obliquely it is going from one layer of the dura and then entering the cavernous sinus. And on top of that, there is a ligamentous structure, which is petrosphenoid ligament or Gruber's ligament. Here also you can see the more of this petrous apex can be drilled to have access to this area. So this is the whole of the dissection from endoscopic point of view. You can see six nerve, very oblique course, goes behind the ICA, and then that enters this venous confluence here, and then it goes into the cavernous sinus. Of course, here I have preserved the dura, and just to show this branch, this is a dorsal meningeal artery, which is a branch of meningohypophyseal trunk. So now coming to posterior lateral, this is also called Glasgow triangle, and the content mainly is this. You can see here is the artery. This is the middle meningeal artery. So from endoscopic point of view, this is very lateral. Here you can see all the dissection of the infratemporal fossa has been done. These are all branches of mandibular nerve here. So if you see, there is an internal maxillary artery, which is related to branches of mandibular nerve. And you can see there is this middle meningeal artery arising and entering the skull base here, technically just leading to middle. Of course, inferior, then we have the clival triangles, which are in relation to your entry of the fourth nerve, and this is the sixth nerve. So if you see the inferomedial triangle, you can see this. Here we have the third nerve here, and this is the sixth nerve here. Sixth nerve entering, third nerve is practically, you can say, fourth nerve. So these are the, this is the area which again we are seeing from the clivus point of view. So this is the inferolateral triangle. Inferolateral triangle, you can just imagine it is just the porous of this Meckel's cave. So this is the entry of the Meckel's cave. So this is the triangular area which is called inferolateral triangle. So this is here from endoscopic, you can see fifth nerve. Then we have this arachnoid around the Gasserian ganglion. And of course, then it divides into three branches here. You can see from inferior aspect. And then you can see here some part of the seventh, eighth nerve complex and this ICA going into the internal auditory meatus. So this is again a beautiful picture showing all of the dissection of the skull base cranial nerves. You can say basilar artery with arachnoid preserved. You can see sixth nerve going very oblique. We have fifth nerve, we have seventh, eighth, we have lower cranial. And then we have 12th nerve going into the hypoglossal canal. Of course, this is very long journey of the ICA in the skull base. We have parapharyngeal related to atlanto-axial joints, atlanto-occipital joints here. Then we have petrous part, which is all the petrous has been drilled here, related to mandibular nerve here. And here comes your foramen lacerum, then paraclival, then going into the paracellar, and then the paraclinoid. So this is the whole journey of endoscopic roadmap, you can say, of the ICA in the skull base. So parapharyngeal, then we have this petrous part, then we have paralateral part here, then paraclival, paracellar, and this is paraclinoid. This is the cella here. This is V1, this is V2, and this is V3. So these all nerves and vessels, how they are arranged in skull base is very, very interesting. So these are different types of cella. You can see all this. This is a top-up view of this, all the cavernous sinus anatomy, microscopic anatomy. You have ICA, meningohypophyseal trunk. You have inferior hypophyseal artery going to the posterior pituitary. You have a dorsal meningeal artery going to the clivus, supplying the sixth nerve here. And you can see the sixth nerve here entering the Dorello's canal. This is the venous confluence. This is petrosphenoid ligament. Here you can see better Gruber's ligament, tie-shaped ligament, which I showed you through endoscope also. So this is again fifth nerve, third nerve, fourth nerve. So this is all in all, you can see beautiful picture of cavernous sinus with all the arteries and cella. And this is, of course, sometime we do brainstem dissection, not relevant to this course. So in short, what I want to say is once, of course, I can show you in 3D also, we wanted to come there and show, but due to some COVID situation, it is not possible. But this is all, anatomy is all three-dimensional. So you do a lot of dissection, you do a lot of cadaveric work, then you can make this whole picture in your mind. So you don't need virtual simulation and all those things. Of course, they are important, but you needs hands on dissection to do to learn this anatomy. With this I conclude, and thanks for this opportunity. Thank you.